In the name of God, we will start the last session for today, session for Russia's relations with non-Arab regional powers, the impact on the Arab world. We will have four speakers in this session. Mr. Rod Thornton, to my left. Mrs. Lana Ravandi-Fadai, to my right. Mr. Hasan Özertem, on the very left. And Mr. Mahmoud Muhareb, on the very right. The first speaker, so the session will last for an hour and a half, and we will try to respect the timetable that was set, 15 minutes for each speaker, and then we will have half an hour for the discussions and for the final remarks of the speakers. The first speaker is Mr. Rod Thornton. He works at King's College University, professor at King's College in London, and currently based at the Joanne bin Jassim Joint Command and Staff College in Wakra. His original degree being in Russian, Thornton has written widely on the Russian military. He has lived and worked in both Kiev and Moscow, and he has written Threat and Response in the 21st Century Polity Press. He has 15 minutes. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Conscious of time, so I'll kind of compress my talk as much as I possibly can without. Excuse me while I, thank you. Okay, I'm going to talk about Russia-Iran relations. And we've heard two words used today to describe the relationship, I think, already. Realism and pragmatism. Basically, there's no true real bond between Russia and Iran. It's about what's good for both. There's no kind of solid friendship between the two countries. And I think that's the basic theme of my talk today. What links do we have between these two countries? Firstly, they're neighbors. They have a long history of living next door to each other. I mean, there's no real border between the two these days, but historically there has been. And these two countries have a shared history of sometimes of for instance, Russia occupied northern Iran after the Second World War, or during the Second World War, and afterwards the Great Patriotic War. So, and Russia and Iran have had their wars before, and the relationship between them is not the best, historically, given that they are neighbors. Today, in the Caucasus, there is a link between Russia and Iran. They both want to see a peaceful Caucasus. Therefore, Iran does not agitate for any kind of terrorist activity in, say, Dagestan, Chechnya, Ingushetia, these kinds of places. It doesn't push that. It doesn't try to be antagonistic towards Russian interests in the Caucasus, and in that we can include Armenia, Azerbaijan, Nagorno-Karabakh. These issues, Iran tries to resolve them and not cause problems for Russia. Central Asia, we've talked about already, and both Iran and Tehran and Moscow want to see a peaceful Central Asia, free as much as possible of Chinese and American influence. So basically both, in a nutshell, both Russia and Iran want to see a Central Asia which is peaceful, yes, but is devoid of Chinese and American interference. Afghanistan is a problem because both countries see Afghanistan being a future source of extremism, militancy, that might overspill into both Russia and into Iran. So both Moscow and Tehran are working together to try and control a situation in Afghanistan. The Caspian Sea. There are disputes over the kind of the borders within the Caspian Sea, and Russia and Iran do have differences over where those lines should be, but they are not in a major disagreement over how to divide up the Caspian Sea. It will be resolved eventually. Iraq and Syria. We've talked a lot about these already. Iraq, obviously, Iran and Russia both want to see a stable Iraq, and they want to try and keep out as much as possible any extremist Sunni militancy, ISIS, ISIL, Daesh, and to control Daesh as much as possible. It's in both countries' interests, Russia and Iran, to control Daesh. Iraq can be a major friend of Russia, and obviously the Iranian influence in Iraq is quite strong. So there's a link there. Syria, we've talked a lot about that already. I think I would add to that is the fact that for Russia, Russia is very conscious of the fact that it has to be seen to be a good ally to Bashar al-Assad. Because if it's not seen to be a good ally to Syria, to the Syrian regime, other countries around the world will say, oh, Russia is not a true friend. Because as soon as the going got difficult, Russia abandoned Bashar al-Assad. So it's important for Russia, because Russia can't get friends through economic influence or kind of massive military influence. It can get friends around the world, which it needs. It doesn't want to be isolated. It gets friends around the world by showing what a good friend it can be to places like Syria. Finally, the energy issues. We'll talk more about these later on, but the two countries are linked with their oil and gas interests. I would end this first section by saying that Russia has a history of using its relationship with Iran as leverage to improve relationships with other countries, with other more important countries to Russia than Iran. What motivates the current increase in Russian attentions towards Iran? Basically, after the Maidan events, the Ukraine situation, with the sanctions imposed on Russia by the West, that Russia needs friends. It needs friends badly. So it looks to the BRICS countries and it looks to Iran to try and balance out the fact that it's under such pressure from the West. It needs friends. It doesn't want to feel isolated. It's also lost friends in the Middle East, Libya, for instance, other kind of Iraq, going back. Russia hasn't got the influence in the Middle East that it did once have. And it wants to kind of reignite its influence by looking more towards Iran than it has done in the past. Russia is economically in a bit of a mess, and it needs as much trade as it possibly can get. Selling nuclear reactors to Iran is good business, and selling arms to Iran is good business. It also provides leverage in terms of Iran being kind of in the ambit, in the orbit of Moscow. What Russia is also currently concerned about is the fact that Iran might take over the supplies of gas to Europe from Russia. So currently, Russia has leverage in Europe by providing energy through its gas supply to most of Europe. Now, if Iran took over that business, if Western Europe went to Iran for its gas, Russia would lose complete leverage over events in Europe. So what Russia is trying to do at the moment is to try and kind of increase its relationship with Iran so that Iran doesn't kind of go behind Russia's back and become the major supplier of gas to Europe. Russia also gets influenced by being an intermediary between the West and Iran. And it uses that for its own particular realpolitik benefits, the fact that it has that power of being the intermediary. Okay. But Russia can't go too far in its relationship with Iran. Basically, it has other friends in the Middle East, the GCC countries, to a degree, and Israel, of course. If it becomes too friendly, if it supplies Iran with too many weapons and it's kind of seen to be too close to Iran, Russia will lose friends elsewhere in the Middle East. So Russia will not go too far towards Tehran in their relationships. It will hang back a bit. Okay. Also, even though the relationship between Washington and Moscow is really at the moment quite bad, Russia doesn't want to push America too far with its relationship with Iran. It has to hold back a bit, because to retain leverage influence with Washington, it can't go too far towards Iran. Otherwise, Washington will say, why do we need to talk to Russia? An important factor is Russia does not want a nuclear-armed Iran. A nuclear-armed Iran, an Iran with nuclear weapons, will create instability in the Middle East. Russia does not want instability. It wants a stable Middle East for the most part. And a nuclear-armed Iran will destroy that stability. The S-300, we've heard a lot about this particular missile. It's an anti-aircraft missile. It can shoot down planes. And what it means basically is the fact that, in its simplest terms, it is a strategic weapon. By supplying it to Iran eventually, Russia will alter the strategic balance in the Middle East, because it means that Israeli planes cannot possibly contemplate trying to bomb Bushehr or Natanz or any of the Iranian nuclear facilities without the risk of fear of being shot down. Their planes would be prevented from carrying out such missions by the presence of the S-300 system. It's been promised recently to Iran. Putin has said, yes, we will supply the system to you, Iran, but it's not going to appear for many years, several years. Russia hasn't got S-300 anti-aircraft systems lying around to deliver immediately to Iran. There's going to be a few years down the line. But Putin has said to Iran, you can have these. We will supply these. So Putin has used this as a kind of method of gaining friendship with Iran in case in future Iran decides, if the nuclear talks, the P5 plus one talks, eventually get rid of sanctions on Iran, Iran will turn to its friends around the world to place orders for goods and services. And if Russia comes forward and says, yes, you can have the S-300, Russia will look good in Iranian eyes, and Iran, the thinking is, will then ask for and buy more material from Russia itself. So the S-300 is important. We saw an agreement last year for the Russians to build these extra two nuclear reactors in Bushehr. We've talked about that. I won't talk about that too much. Russia does not want to see a weak Iran. It wants Iran to be a middling power, not too strong, not too weak, because it sees Iran as a balancer. Remember, I said Russia wants stability in the Middle East, and one way of gaining that is to have balancer countries which kind of oppose other power blocks within the Middle East. So Russia looks upon Iran as being a power broker and an influence, and doesn't want Iran to be too weak. Okay, what does Iran get out of the relationship with Russia? Obviously, Iran itself does not want to be diplomatically isolated. It needs friends just as Russia needs friends. And in this case, Russia has shown itself to be a friend. But obviously, as I said before, this relationship will not go too far because it's pragmatic friendship. It's realistic friendship. It's not kind of we love you kind of friendship. Okay, so Tehran also needs an economic partner during the sanctions regime. It needs to get goods and services from somewhere if sanctions are being imposed on it from the Western side. Okay. So it needs Russia in that sense. It needs Russian help in nuclear negotiations. It's very hard for Tehran on its own to conduct negotiations with the P5 plus one without the kind of skill, the knowledge base, and the adroitness that the Russians can help the Iranians with. And obviously, to maintain the Bushehr nuclear reactor, Tehran needs Russian help. It needs Russian technicians and engineers to help it run these particular power stations. It needs Russian help, basically. So some issues I finally kind of look at. Russia isn't going to be that much of a help to Iran in the long run. All Russia can supply is basically nuclear reactors and armaments. What Iran needs is high-tech stuff, high-tech engineering equipment to upgrade its oil facilities and to develop a liquefied natural gas capacity. Russia hasn't got the skills to do that. So therefore, Russia can't supply those kind of things. Other Western countries, Germany especially, can. The relationship is dogged by the internecine struggles within Iran itself, and so we're never quite sure how the relationship will shape up in the future, given the power plays within Iran itself. Iran doesn't really trust Russia because in the past, in 2010, Russia famously stopped supply or said it would not supply the S-300 to Iran, even though these things were already about to be sent to Iran. Future of the relationship, it's based on pragmatism, as I've said. If the relationship with the West deteriorates even further, then Russia may look more towards Iran than it already does. So the relationship will be based on other events around the globe. How will the talks go? If sanctions are lifted on Iran, then Russia will lose out. Russia will lose out because it will no longer be the intermediary between Iran with sanctions on it and the West. If the West is trading freely with Iran, Russia is not needed and can be sidelined. And Russia obviously doesn't want that. And if Assad goes in Syria, then Russia will need then to look upon Iran as even more of a balancer in the Middle East and will provide it with even more support. But these are kind of hypothetical issues that depend on various things happening. But it goes back to my point that Russia and Iran have a very pragmatic relationship which can change at any minute based on the interests of each individual state. There's no kind of common bond, there's no link, there's no love between Iran and Russia. Thank you.
Shukran le Rod Thornton.
I would like to thank Rod Thornton. The second speaker is Lana, Ravandi-Fadai. You have 15 minutes, ma'am. The floor is yours.
Хотел поблагодарить организаторов за приглашение российской стороны, потому что в прошлом году здесь, в Катаре, тоже в Дохе, проходила тоже такая солидная, интересная конференция, но, к сожалению, никого из представителей России не было. Спасибо. Значит, 2 апреля этого года иранский народ, иранцы, все иранцы вышли на улицу, и многие несли фотографии Хасана Рухани, праздновали прорыв переговоров по иранской ядерной программе, которую проходили в Лозанне.
They went to the streets carrying Rouhani's pictures in the streets, and then the talks with the 6 countries, and that was carried out. In the background, there was a telephone call intervention by Obama, but in many countries, and especially so in the Arab Middle East and in Israel, they were worried how to what extent there could be a rapprochement between the two sides and how that impact the current coalitions and how the geostrategic role, the Iranian geostrategic role would increase in the future. And those issues were also discussed in Russia. Would that be conducive to ending the relationship between Russia and Iran and increasing isolation of Russia as a result? Would that Russia showed some support for the talks? And now some analysts stress that perhaps Iran would replace Russia in supplying gas to Europe. Mr. Putin actually signed a decree to cancel the embargo of the air defense weapons for Iran, and the Russo-Iranian relations were never that simple. And there's also another historical view as well. I changed my intervention for a reason. Why? Because there is a question here. Why would Russia support Iran in the last decades? The Russo-Iranian relations have developed. They have not been stationary in the past few years. Iran never constituted a threat to Russia. On the contrary, it helped to solve a host of international issues. And in 1995, Russia agreed to sign George Chernomyrdin, a secret memorandum, where actually pledged to end the contracts with Iran in relation to the weapons supplies, and not to start new contracts. The Russian damages were no less than $4 billion, and Iran during those years sought to preserve the friendly relations between Russia and Iran, like Turkey, which sought to increase its influence, and Iran, of course, abandoned the export of the Iranian Revolution to beyond the Caucasus, and after the rebellion of the Chechen rebels, the Iranian leadership said that it would not intervene in such issues, consider them to be internal domestic affairs for Russia. And it's clear that Iran sees its relations with Russia, that it is more, it's higher than any other problems, and showed, and the Iranian leaders expressed their position and showed their position when the Iranian authorities were supporting the Russian position, and also Iran was supporting the Russian position in relation to Georgia and Ingushetia. And in spite of the American pressures, Iran, there was a closer relationship between Iran and Russia, where people actually considered Iran being considered one of the axis of evils countries, and Russia did not support such positions at all, and unlike the US, which described Iran as a terrorist state. Indeed, Iran was considered by the US as a element of constructive cooperation in the southern areas of Russia, where there are internal divisions in the Caucasian Russian republics. And this is unlike the efforts and endeavors of the other countries. In September 2000, there was actually important pivotal principles for dividing the areas of influence in the Caspian Sea, and you know that the issue, the situation of the legal situation of the Caspian Sea has not been resolved yet and may not be resolved, in fact, in the near future. And as a result, there are preparations, military and attempts to exploit the oil resources by violent means, and due to the sanctions on Iran, the Russo-Iranian relations have been a number of projects between the two countries have been cancelled. If they had been established, they would have supported the international positions for Iran and Russia. And there is a horizon as well for Iran's participating in the joint efforts to counter against anti-crime and narcotics efforts and the transfer of goods in the territories, Iranian and Russian territories, and other international and technical and Russian military projects, which are still at the level of the talks. And if in April 2007, and in a meeting of the gas exporting countries in Qatar, there have been decisions taken in relation to the policies of those countries, and then Russia and Qatar and Iran talked about the establishment of a joint project for supply of Iranian gas and marketing it in international markets. However, when the American Congress took a decision for judicial prosecution or measures against any country that tried to establish gas links with Iran, this has been frozen as a result of this project. And then Iran developed its relations and its positions. And Iran loses the potential markets for exporting its gas. Iran comes ranked the third after Russia in relation to natural gas resources. Initially, there was military cooperation, a traditional cooperation between the countries, which was successful, and Russia had all the essential factors that impart on this kind of cooperation a natural and international character, so that Iran cannot strengthen their offensive capabilities, but their defensive capabilities. And any development, there was a development in the atomic and the nuclear technologies and the space project, and they're building Bushehr station and launching a satellite, a joint project of Iranian-Russian satellite. And Iran, as far as Russia is concerned, is not a trade partner. And Russia is content with the Iranian position vis-a-vis a number of international issues. Iran is an important key country which can help achieve the Russian objectives, which can ward off major threats, but of the resources of the Caspian Sea will be transferred, will be transported across the third countries, which is against the Iranian and Russian interests. And the time left is very short, but I want to say that all the experts, including Russian ones, believe that the cancellation of lifting the sanctions against Iran, it does not help Russia, and that Iran prefers the West actually to Russia. But perhaps I do not agree with the view, this kind of view, because if we take into account now the trade relations, economic relations are at the zero level, which actually diminishing every year by 40%, and last year did not reach 1 billion in the trade relations. But historically, we have a historical view. We find that in Khatami, during Khatami's, when Iran was close to the West, and in the era of the Iranian Shah, the Shah of Iran, there were close economic relations between Iran and our countries. And I believe that if we, in July, achieve a success, that many of the Russian companies, such as Gazprom, Neft, will return to the Iranian market, and will witness an improvement of the Russian-Iranian relations. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much. Feeling that the shortage of time, I actually overlooked introducing the previous speaker. He's a lecturer in Farsi languages in Moscow, who published many articles about the internal affairs of Iranian. He obtained the master's from the Moscow State University and International Relations, PhD from the Department of Iranian Studies and the Institute of Oriental Studies, Moscow. Our next speaker is Hasan Özertem, who is the Center of Strategic Studies, and he also participates in a series about Turkey in Marshall Fund, and also one of the Turkey's prominent foreign policy monthlies, The Analyst. He's also the co-editor of the academic journal Review of International Law and Politics. His research interests our security, political economy, energy, elite politics, Russia, the Caspian Basin, and Turkish foreign policy. The floor is yours, sir, and you have 15 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your patience and standing up until the last session. I'm a little bit luckier than the last speaker, I suppose. Today, I'm going to talk about Turkish-Russian relations in 2000s particularly. That's why Doha Institute asked me to present. And I would like to also express my gratitude for their kind invitation. I have three arguments of my presentation regarding Turkish-Russian relations. The first of all, Russia and Turkey succeeded to develop their relations rapidly in 2000s. But the bilateral affairs has started to stagnate in the second decade of the century. As of 2015, the parties continue to compartmentalize their relations, but the dispute between Russia and the West threatens the future of bilateral relations. And thirdly, Russia's tendency to pursue zero-sum gain policy also threatens the future of bilateral relations between Turkey and Russia. Considering the phases of bilateral relations between Russian Federation and Turkey, we may talk about three phases since 1992. The first phase can be described as the years of uncertainties, which takes us up until 2000s. The second phase is the phase of years of momentum. It's almost a decade-long period. The third phase is the phase of compartmentalization, but also stagnation of relations. It is up until the end of 2014. And there are questions about the current situation. Did we reach to the limits of the possible in Russian-Turkish relations? As you might see from the map, Russia and Turkey geographically are really close to each other. And looking at the years of uncertainties between 1990s and 2000s, we can talk about more negative factors rather than positive factors that shape the relations between Russia and Turkey. I'll not get into details of these factors, but we may talk about them as reflexes of the Cold War, as both countries belonged to different blocs. One of them was a member of NATO, the other one was the head of Warsaw Pact. There were counterbalancing policies via PKK or Chechen fighters during the 1990s by two countries, which undermined the relations. And we may see that both in Russia and Turkey, there were weak governments, weak administrations, which caused domestic politics to dominate the foreign policy in these years. But still, we may talk about positivities of 1990s. Parties succeeded to keep the music going after the collapse of the USSR. Russia, being recognized by Turkey, continued to develop their relations, but still in low level. But while the governments had low level of interaction, particularly the people-to-people interaction gained a great momentum in 1990s, particularly by the private sector of Turkey, who went into Russia to make business, particularly in the construction sector and trade sector, and also Russians who came to Turkey for shuttle trade and also for tourism in these years. Then came the years of 2000s. Regarding the main characteristics of 2000s, we may talk about four main characteristics. One of them is the economic trade between Russia and Turkey rapidly grew. It was around $4.5 billion in 2001, and it reached to and peaked in 2008 with $38 billion. In these years, we see strategic relations between Russia and Turkey developed really fast, particularly in the energy area, which is a kind of security area but non-military area. In this regard, the parties finalized an important pipeline export project, which has 16 billion cubic meters gas capacity per year, which is known as Blue Stream, and it is passing beneath the Black Sea. And also, in 2010, the parties agreed to build a nuclear power plant on the coast of Mediterranean in Turkey. And in these years, also, both parties institutionalized their relations and agreed to meet their leaders each and every year, 1 year in Turkey and 1 year in Russia, respectively, and called this mechanism as High-Level Cooperation Council, which I will get into details later. As a fruit of this council, they decided to remove the visa requirements mutually for short-term visits, which was something impossible during the Cold War period, but after two decades of the collapse of Soviet Union, Turkish citizens started to get into Russia without any visas. And in 2001, the parties agreed to establish a consortium regarding the security of the Black Sea, and instead of letting third parties to get into the business of Black Sea, they created Black Sea Four, composed of Russia, Turkey, and other leader states in Black Sea to sustain the security dynamics in the region. And also, these were the years which were not independent of crises. Of course, we had Georgian crisis in 2008, but Turkey and Russia succeeded to avoid to create some diplomatic conflicts or some hot conflicts in the Caucasus. Looking at these years, as I told you before, the trade between two countries increased rapidly. As you might see, it was stagnated during the 1990s, but it peaked in 2008 and then decreased due to financial crisis in 2008 to the level of $23 billion. Then we see normalization in the trade, bilateral trade between the parties, and then again we reach to the level of $30 billion, between the level of $30 billion to $35 billion in bilateral trade. What were the reasons behind this rapid development during 2000s? I may talk about a couple of them. One of them was it was independent from these two countries' rapprochement, because there was this expansion dynamics in global economy, particularly in developing countries, and as Turkey and Russia are part of middle-income countries at the beginning of 2000s, their per capita income increased from the level of $2,000 per person to over $10,000 at the end of 2008. And this also stimulated the relations in economic terms, as these two economies are really close to each other. And also we may talk about downsizing of the geopolitical risks in 2000s. There were Chechen problem in 2000s, but Putin managed to take under control the Chechen problem. And Russia started to decline its support to PKK. For instance, they closed the PKK office in Moscow, and they declined to host Abdullah Öcalan, the head of PKK, in Moscow when he was searching for a refuge in 1999. Then we can talk about strong leadership, both in Turkey and Russian Federation. And this created an Erdogan-Putin tandem. And also, we saw in this expansion of these relations, correlation between rising energy prices and strengthening energy cooperation because of finalizing new pipeline projects between Russia and Turkey. And also, we should underline the fact that Russia and Turkey are complementary economies. Turkey consumes Russian energy, and in return, Turkey sells capital goods and agricultural goods to Russian market. Weren't there any deficiencies? For sure, increasing energy independence of Turkish market to Russian Federation in natural gas mainly happened in this period. It rose to 60%. Now Russian Turkish dependence on Russian gas is 60%. And also the trade balance that started to take form in 2000 become deteriorated in favor of Russia. The balance became 20% of Turkish share in trade volume and 80% of share in Russia due to the dominance of the energy market. You may see the change in energy cooperation. So we reached to the years of compartmentalization. It's because of the, thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's because of the political crisis and also ongoing in the interdependence between the economies. But also, looking at the years of compartmentalization, we also see stagnation of economic cooperation between Russia and Turkey. Both of these countries failed to surpass the level that they reached in 2008. They never passed the threshold of $35 billion of trade volume in this period. And also, we see compartmentalization of relations in the crises like Syria and Ukraine. The parties decided to agree on disagree. Even though they continued their dialogue, they didn't manage to come into a common point regarding the political crisis in their neighborhood. But they still continued to cooperate in bilateral level, and they put a target at the end of 2014 to reach $100 billion at the end of 2013 in bilateral trade relation. You may see the stagnation of economic cooperation from this graph very well. So how we compartmentalize our relations with Russia? As I told, there was this high level of cooperation council which was established in 2010. According to this council, there are three different subcommittees. They work throughout the year and plan what's to be discussed between the leaders. And the leaders, whatever happens, even their health problems, even their economic crisis, etc., they get together each and every year. So this helps, even though Russia and Turkey have different points, to leaders to come together and discuss the issues in a healthy manner. So what about the stagnation? What about the reasons behind the stagnation? We can talk about slowing down economic growth in Russia and Turkey, stagnating and declining energy prices, failing to open new areas of cooperation other than conventional cooperation items like energy, tourism, and agricultural products. That's why, you know, economic relations between Russia and Turkey stagnated. How parties compartmentalize, I'll not get into detail. I can come to this question and answers session. So we reached to the limits of possible in 2015. We are in a critical point with Russia. Because of Russian policies in Ukraine, this created some security challenge in the Black Sea. Russia changed the balance in the Black Sea in favor of itself, but this undermined the status quo that was established with Black Sea for in 2001. Economic challenge, increasing tension between Russia and the West, leading to sanctions. It started to affect the tourists coming from Russia to Turkey. It was 4.5 million people last year, but in the first quarter, the decrease is around 40% in Turkey. And also, the trade started to decline to Russia, exports of Turkey to Russia as well at the beginning of 2015's first quarter. Secondly, Russia's Sinatra doctrine. I do it my way, you know. I do not talk to others when I take steps. And Turkey's sensitivities are the main reason. 2 minutes, please. For this limits of the possible. I may talk about Armenian issue, which is one of the main sensitivities of Turkey, but Putin talk about genocide, Medvedev talk about genocide, and Duma took a decision on genocide. And as a result, Turkish president chose not to go to the Victory Day in 9th of May to celebrate the 17th anniversary of the Second World War. And another important thing, this Sinatra doctrine also causes tension between the West and Russia. And in the final terms, Turkey is a member of NATO and it has some institutional problems to keep up with Russian steps in the region. Efforts to, but in return to these problems, there are some prospects as well for the future, because Russia tries to expand the scale of energy cooperation with Turkey. I may also touch upon in the Q&A session. So, to conclude, I may say that we reached to years of momentum, to years of compartmentalization, and then the limits of possible. We failed to transform the cooperation into sustainable strategic partnership due to strategic barriers. There is good cooperation economics in economic sphere, but limited success in regional political cooperation rather than strengthening divergences. And rising risks due to ongoing dispute between the West and Russia have potential to shadow the future of bilateral cooperation between Turkey and Russia. What is next? I believe we reach to the limits of leaders-led diplomacy. We need deepening the institutional framework and diversification of cooperation in economic and political terms. Need for transforming economies from upper middle class to high income country levels. For this, both countries need innovation policies. Or we will be see further stagnation in the policies in the upcoming period, or there is a possibility of, which would be an unfortunate possibility, of a downward trend between Turkish-Russian relations in the way to the 2020s. Thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you very much. تبقى لنا المتحدث الرابع.
So we will introduce Mr. Muhareb. He's an associate researcher at the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies, a Palestinian academic. His publications cover Zionism and Israel, the Palestinian cause, and the Arab-Israeli conflict. Muhareb earned his PhD in political science from the University of Reading in the UK. The floor is yours, sir. 15 minutes.
Shukran, Dr. Noor.
Thank you very much, Dr. Noor. This intervention reached the relation between Israel and Russia and the both countries' visions about the foundations of such relations, areas of agreement and disagreement between the two countries, and the concern of those countries that any disputes or disagreements between them should not have a negative impact on the bilateral relations. The main issue that the continued occupation, Israeli occupation of Palestinian territories, resolving the Palestinian cause, the Iranian nuclear program, and Israel's possession of nuclear weapons, and these issues, there is an attempt that they would not impact the good relations that both countries want to ensure that they exist between them. When Mikhail Gorbachev came to power in 1985, the Soviet Union started to change its relations with Israel within the context of its strategy adopted vis-a-vis the U.S. and other Western powers. In 1987, the Soviet Union and Israel agreed to establish consular relations between the two countries. In 1989, the two countries opened consulates in Moscow and Tel Aviv. In October 1991, the two countries established full diplomatic relations between them. Then Russia and Israel attach great importance to the bilateral relations, and they are continuing to enhance those relations. During Yeltsin, they tried to do that, and also under Putin. Israel realized that Russia is an important force in the world, and they also realize it's not a major power, but they realize it's an important force which has a great impact on the developments and issues, events in the Middle East, that also enjoys influence in the Middle East. Israel started to promote relation with Palestine for ensuring its interest. One, the immigration of the Jews from the former Soviet countries to Israel, developing the overall economic and strategic and relations, and in the areas of science, high technology, and also the military relations between the countries and developing the common concepts between the two countries in relation to conflicts in the Middle East, to develop common policies between the two countries, to influence the developments of the events in the Middle East, for to reach understanding with Russia about not supplying many countries in the Middle East, especially in the past, many other countries as well, other than Syria. So today, Syria, Iran, which would constitute, might constitute a threat or bring an end to the Israel-Israeli military supremacy in the Middle East, and also disrupt the balance, the military balance between Israel and the Arab countries, and between Israel and Iran. So not to supply Iran with S-300 missiles. Russia considers Israel a Western, fully developed country economically and technologically, and also has an important standing and as an important force in the Middle East. And there are including some factors which would help the Russian interests in the Middle East and also in the world. However, on the other hand, there are also factors, negative factors, as far as Russia is concerned, as a result of the close relations between Israel and the U.S. However, Russia seeks to exploit its relations with Israel to achieve a number of objectives, foremost among which the development of the trade and economic relations between the countries in the areas of science and high technology with Israel. Second, making use of the high technology in Israel, especially the technology that falls within the remit of military industries, such as the drones. Third, Russia looks at Israel and Jews in the world as one unity, one unit, and Russia, through its relation with Israel, seeks to benefit from it and from the Jews in the world, especially in Western countries and issues of concern and interest to Russia. Fourth, Russia tries to play the role of intermediary to solve the Arab-Israeli conflict, and in many cases, and if not in most of them, this affects its tolerant state with the position with the Israeli occupation and the crimes committed, as we'll see later, by Israel in its aggression on the Palestinians. Russia and Israel have signed 10 cooperation agreements between the two countries since 1994 until 2010. In 1994, both countries signed 6 agreements of mutual cooperation, areas of science and technology, tourism, culture, education, health, medicine, agriculture, industrial agriculture, and aeronautics. And in 1991, they signed an agreement to go in the post and also another one, and fight counterterrorism and crimes. And there's another one about taxes and the position of both countries in the in 2010. Both countries also signed an important agreement for the security and military cooperation between the two countries and the trade balance between the countries, two countries, in Israel and the Soviet Union, 1995, about $500 million, 2013, 2014, about $2 billion. I will now address some of the issues which I consider to be important in the relations between Russia and Israel, foremost among which is the immigration of Russian Jews to Israel and the Russian position vis-à-vis the immigrants. The Jewish immigrants to Israel. The end of the 80s, Israel and the United States had intensive negotiations with the Soviet Union to allow the Jewish immigrants to immigrate, and this actually led to allowing large numbers, unprecedented numbers, to immigrate, and then it became clear to the Israelis that the majority of those Jews from the Soviet Union who are immigrating would go to the US and other countries, and that a small minority would actually immigrate to Israel. In 1989, 72,000 Jews immigrated from Russia, about 17% only, actually, headed for Israel, and 83% of them actually went to the U.S. and other countries. the estimates of the Israeli circles concerned with immigration of Jews from the Soviet Union, that 95% of the Jews who would immigrate from the Soviet Union would actually immigrate to the US and other countries, and that only 5% would end up immigrating to Israel. And given this situation, Israel started to cooperate with Jewish organizations in the US and made extensive efforts to convince the American administration to demand, to give up on its demand of free immigration, because the US actually stressed the importance of free immigration for Jews and non-Jews. And actually, the American administration, after an effort from the Jewish lobby in Israel to abandon and to stop the U.S. would cease to receiving Jewish immigrants to the U.S. And also, the Israel made efforts in its ongoing contacts with the Soviet authorities in the last year, in the last 2 years of the Soviet Union before its breakup, to persuade the authorities not only give visas to Israel, but they all agreed that visas would be issued for Israel, for every Jews who wanted to immigrate from the Soviet Union. They also opened an ongoing line route between the two countries for immigration. As for the Soviet Union, in the last 2 years of the Soviet Union, also in Russian Federation, there was practically not only a right for the Jews to leave the Soviet Union or the Soviet citizen to leave the Soviet Union, but not only that, but also forcing them, if they wanted to immigrate, a large percentage of them wanted to immigrate, that to end up to go to Israel. And since the, let's say, 1989 to 2014, about 1,150,000 Jews immigrated from the Soviet Union. And when, after the breakup of the Soviet Union, the Russian Federation, the immigration continued afterwards until this very day, about 1,150,000. This immigration had an impact on Israel in all aspects, one of which the important changes in the demographic issues and also the advanced industries and scientific and intellectual and cultural had a great impact on the Palestinian cause and the so-called the demographic problem or issue in Israel. At the end of the 80s, there was extensive discussion and sharp, heated discussion between two directions. And one expansionist did not pay any attention to the demographic issue, but wanted to keep and to continue the occupation of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip and the Eastern Jerusalem, East Jerusalem. And there's another current, a movement that wanted a solution, halfway solution, the withdrawal from part of the Western Bank. The Jewish immigration had 100, this number of people enhanced the expansionist, colonialist expansion of the Israelis. Not only that, but we say, for instance, that what, or wonder, what did Israel, the kind, quality, the kind of immigrants, the vast majority, about 57%, or academics, about a million. Out of the million and 100,000 immigrants, 100,000 engineers, 20,000 doctors, 24,000 nurses, 45,000 teachers, 20,000 workers and musicians and artists. And this actually increased Israel's power. And there's another problem that I deal with very briefly, because there are two other issues I want to actually talk about. Russian position vis-a-vis the Jewish immigrants since the start of the immigration until this very day. That's from the 90s until this very day. Putin reiterated several times that as a result of the presence of Russians, he should keep good relations and pay attention to their well-being. Russia allowed them to keep the Russian citizenship and their passports. Russian passports. And this is here, there's a problem. But the one what's more problematic is about 15% of those, they settled down in East Jerusalem and West Bank. A large number of the Knesset members and ministers are among those who immigrated live in the West Bank. Here we have a problem, because today, if Russia wanted to play a role and its position, which is opposed to the occupation, should increase its position, change the position to those that withdraw the nationality, the citizenship, and second, they boycott them. Russia could boycott them. Here, the colonial settlement, it's a colonialist settlement. Putin cannot come now and say that we actually pay attention to our relation with Israel and affects our relation with Israel, and that we support Israel in protecting those people, because a number of them, a part of them, the democratic issue in favor of the Israel, but at least it's possible for Putin or the politicians to deal with them with the same orientation that we see in Europe, imposing sanctions against the settlers. And this is one thing. Second, percentage of them does not only serve in the army, but they are among the leaders, military leaders, for they have your citizens and you are proud of the relationship that they become serving in the army. Very briefly now, I'm going to talk about the Palestinian cause, the official Russian position in relation to the Palestinian cause, the same that removing the occupation, establishing the Palestinian state on the borders of the June 1976. This is only a theoretical position, does not affect the practical policies which would require a country that's not a major power, but rather a regionally important power seeking to establish relations with Israel to exert genuine efforts, or minimum of efforts, in fact, to impact, to lead to the removal of the occupation. Since the 90s until this very day, the fact that the Russians are intermediaries, mediators, but within the context that they put themselves as mediators. They overlooked essential core issues. You have just 1 minute, please, to allow the continuation of the occupation, the settlement, and not taking any decision action against them. This is an important issue, if you allow me, just to conclude with, namely that the agreement between Russia and Israel on any kind of weapons that supplied to the Arab countries are, in the principle, the fact that Russia supplies Arab countries with weapons do not change or threaten the Israeli supremacy. Israel considered that a major achievement and still considers it to be so. The reason for this is that if the weapons, Russian weapons, that supplied to Syria does not allow them to defend themselves, why would they give them those weapons? Israel is happy with such a situation because when Russia supplies Syria with such weapons, not directed against Israel, and since the October war, 1973 war, until now, it's not addressed, targeted at Israel. Who is it targeted against then? If this weapon is not either targeted at other countries, neighboring countries, or against the people. And this, what happens usually, there's another issue it's important to draw attention to, the Israel's monopoly of nuclear weapons in the Middle East. This issue, Russia is dealing with it not very seriously. Let's take, for example, how do the U.S. deal with any other country in the region? You have exceeded the time allocated. That Russia deals with it as a bargaining tool to negotiate with it to improve its position. Thank you very much.
I would like to thank the four panelists. We have less than half an hour left for the Q&A session, please, you have 2 minutes to make your point in order to allow for the answers to be given. Please be brief, be concise, straight to the point.
تفضل
In the name of God. I have not noticed that the Russian participants were very cautious when it comes to choosing the terminology. Is it because of the security regime in Russia? There's a lot of reservation in terms of the terminology that is used. The Iranian participants also tackled the Arab issues, strategic Arab issues, and I have noticed the same. I would like to say that the US and Russia are playing the role of a good manager and bad manager, and the role is in rotation. Russia has played recently the role of the bad cop or the bad director. Thank you. I would like to correct something that when we talk about super regional power, it's not to undermine the importance of the Russian role. So when we're talking about the regional power, it means that this is a country that spreads two continents. It's important in Europe and in Asia. It is not systematic at the international level. Sometimes we need to clarify the point that we are not trying to undermine Russia's role when we talk about the region. The region that Russia is involved in is Europe and Asia. It's not a small region. It has a bigger responsibility than just a regional state like Turkey and Iran. It is a central key state in Asia and in Europe. The West, the East of Asia, and Europe. So it's a major role. It's like five regional states put all together. So in order not to, I wanted to clarify this impression that we were trying to undermine Russia's role.
Actually, I have an impression that I'd like to share with my dear non-Arab panelist. I feel that, let's say, Iran is actually following the American style in negotiating or betting on more than one horse, let's say, keeping herself open to any scenario. I don't feel that the case with Turkey and Russia. What I mean is, Iran, for example, yeah, when ISIS, you know, this threat, they were ready to help the Iraqi army. But at the same time, when the Kurds asked for help, Turkey, of course, you know, it couldn't help, actually, as it has its own, you know, conception about, you know, the Kurdish issue and so on. But actually, yeah, the Iran also helped the Kurdish army and the Kurdish Peshmerga in this case. Also, what else? I can say that yes, Russia. I don't think they don't have this flexibility, and Turkey as well. Turkey, yeah, they bet on one horse and that's it. But Iran, they keep themselves, you know, open. Let's say with the Iranian American relations, they have, you know, these tense relations, but they still have secret correspondence every now and then, and so on. So this is, you know, the impression. وسؤال لي دكتور محمود. مسألة العلاقات الروسية الإسرائيلية أعتقد أن المسألة أيضا ليست العلاقات بهذه الوردية هناك أيضا بعض الخلافات التي تظهر كل فترة وأخرى مثلا عندما تحسن العلاقات الروسية الإيرانية لا يرضي الطرف الإسرائيلي تماما وعندما بدأت تسلح إيران هددت إسرائيل بعلاقاتها المتميزة مع جورجيا وبالفعل هناك تعاون عسكري بين جورجيا وإسرائيل منذ وقت طويل فهذه القضية أيضا يتم استغلالها كل فترة وأخرى. شكرا.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to intervene regarding one point. The Arab nations imagine that the international diplomacy is simple, predictable, and clear and transparent. However, this is not the case. When we talk about politics, it's always complicated, positions are ambiguous, and the dynamics are very high. Therefore, I hope that when we approach this dossier, we should not think or perceive Russia as the Soviet Union. We should not expect Russia to play the same role played during the day of the Soviet Union. It's a completely different agenda, completely different role, and completely different perspective. Russia today has its prospects and its limitations. I'm not giving, I'm not justifying the Russian role. However, when it comes to the Palestinian cause, let's go back to the 80s after the Glasnost. It's a historical issue. The key Israeli leaders, the generals and the leaders of Israel, came from Russia and from the surrounding countries, the Soviet, the ex-Soviet Union countries. Ben-Gurion, Dayan, they all came from these countries, from this region. So that was my remark. We need to clarify, to change our approach vis-a-vis the role of Russia and our relations with Russia. Today, Russia is another country, and we can play additional efforts in order to convince and influence the Russian position. We need to convince the Russians that their relationship with us are beneficial. Mr. Fassi. Thank you all. I'd like to thank the speakers for their presentations. I have a very short comment, first of all, regarding Mr. Mahmoud's paper regarding the nuclear weapons in Israel. I do not think that Russia is bargaining. I do not think that Russia is using this as a pressure point. Russia is very active in terms of preparing an international conference to make the Middle East exempt from nuclear weapons, including Israel. Regarding the reservations, we do not have any reservations. There is no security regime. If you visit Russia and if you live in Russia, you wouldn't see any security regime. We have done away with this long ago. However, the West media always talk about Putin as if he's a former member of the KGB. The situation is not like this. We are free to say whatever we want. However, we did not have the ample time to tackle critical issues. We are talking about the relations and with the enduring relationship. We have talked about historical relationships starting the 8th century. We had imagined that the first conference would discuss the history in order to build upon these discussions and further conferences. We do not have any reservations whatsoever. Thank you all. I will be talking about what Dr. Mahmoud said and Dr. Fasih as well during the first session. I think that when Russia supplies other countries with weapons, they do not impose political conditions for the use of these weapons. However, Russia has its own set of conditions when it comes to supplying different countries. The S-300 and for Syria, and the S-300s for Iran, and then the other arsenal between Iraq and the former Soviet Union in the 50s and later. We can see that during certain phases, based on the political situation, based on some pressure exerted on Russian leadership, we see that Russia stops supplying weapons to these countries. Warships were about to reach Iraq during the Iraq-Iran war and during the Kurdish revolution, and Russia stopped supplying the weapons, the S-300 back then. The same happened with Iran, and I think that this whole supplying issue that will take place in the year to come, the S-300, I don't see them this issue very simple, and thank you. I'm sorry, I cannot take any further questions because we are short on time. I would like to give the panelists the opportunity to respond 2 minutes each in order to tackle the points that were raised. Dr. Mahmoud Muhareb, the floor is yours. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I agree with what you have said. We talk about Russia as a superpower. We do not ask Russia to play a bigger role than the role it's capable of playing. Russia is capable of playing based on its relationship and its relationship with different parties. It can play a different role when it comes to Palestinian cause and different dossiers. Russia sometimes is using bargaining. It's using the situation in Syria or the Palestinian cause for the negotiations without having a clear policy to implement the objectives of its declared policy and the Arabs' policy. This undermines its position as a country, as a power, as an influential power in the Middle East. As to the nature of the relationship between Russia and Israel, historically, the Soviet Union was supporting with the Arab countries the Palestinian or the liberation movement ideology, and historically, after the fall of the Soviet Union, the relationship between Russia and Israel was based upon new foundations that did away with the previous nature of the relationship between the Soviet Union and Israel and the Soviet Union and the Arab countries. New foundations were set. The two countries were keen to preserve this relationship despite the divergence, the dispute at several levels. However, both parties agreed not to allow these disputes to influence the good relationship between Russia and Israel. Concessions were made, for example, in Georgia. Israel supported or supplied Georgia with weapons. And then it agreed with Russia on the condition that Russia would not supply Iran with S-300s, etc. Historically, when it comes to the perception of Israel to Russia, when it comes to decisive moments, in 1947, 48, and February 49, the Soviet Union played a key role in supporting the Jewish state. There was no talk about the division of Palestine. There was a talk about the Jewish state and based starting in March 48 to February 49. It supplied them with heavy weapons, including air force, Czechoslovakia, Poland. There were camps in Eastern Europe to send Jewish fighters in support of Israel. So Russia has a historical responsibility at this level to contribute to put an end to the occupation. Russia can set a condition. For example, our relationship with Israel should be based on the end of the occupation. It's not like business as usual with this country that is occupying territories. Dr. Hasan Özertem, you have the floor. 2 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank for the question. It's really a wonderful question. I may say that Turkey has some flexibility problems, as you just said. But it's important to underline the fact that Turkey is not a lone wolf. You know, Turkey made its decisions regarding values long before, which goes back to 18th century or 19th century during the Ottoman period. You know, it was always the West that Turkey turned its face towards. It go back to the East because of the dynamics forces to go back to the East. In this regard, Turkey defines itself within the Western world itself. Coming back to 1950s, also Turkey redefined its relations with the West with institutional mechanisms like NATO and then European Union. And now we see that regarding the values, there are no big division between the Western values and Turkish values when it comes to international relations. But coming to technological or other cooperative issues, we may define Turkey as a cooperative power. In this regard, Turkey believes in partnerships, Turkey believes in cooperation, and recent strategic agreements regarding nuclear power with Russia or missile defense system with China shows these kind of issues. But coming back to Kurdish issue, it's not easy for a country who goes to elections each and every 4 years to give decisions really clearly and share it with the public openly. But I may say that I was in Erbil in January 2015, and our counterparts in Erbil, they also confessed that Turkey helped to Kurdistan during the ISIS event. It's delayed a little bit, but the aid came. Secondly, Turkey opened a corridor for Kurdish militia to pass via Turkey to Kobani in 2014. So considering all this, Turkey has its democratic mechanisms, ally responsibilities. All these limit Turkey's maneuverability, but this doesn't mean that Turkish foreign policy isn't that flexible. It's flexible, but not flexible in terms of values.
Thank you. الآن لانا رواني لها دقيقة.
Да, я просто хотела сказать по поводу сдержанности российских ученых. Значит,
I would like to say a couple of words regarding the reserved position of the Russian academics. I agree with Mr. Fasih, who said we are not, nobody prevents us from saying anything that we want. We have a free speech that is preserved. And I was in Virginia Military Institute couple of weeks ago. I have noticed that throughout the world there's an open media war declared against Russia and Iran. And in the United States, I have felt this more than ever. And naturally, when we hear similar speeches, we would like to clarify that the situation is different than what's conveyed by the media. Regarding the S-300, Any country should base the decisions it makes on the interests, on its interests. This is the case, and the S-300 dossier. Netanyahu visited Russia and promised not to supply Georgia with weapons. Similarly, Putin put an end to the boycott, so Israel replied and said it will support Ukraine. So Russia, similarly to other countries, is based on its interests. So we will move to Mr. Rod. The floor is yours. 2 minutes, please.
A very few things at the end here. We should remember that Russia, there's only 600 miles between Grozny, the Chechen capital, and Mosul in Iraq. Russia is quite close to the problem areas of the Middle East. And Russia not only has a Muslim minorities and majorities in its Caucasus region, but also in Bashkortostan and Tatarstan, in the middle of Russia. And any spread of instability from the Middle East is a major threat to Russia. We have to understand, I think, that Russia does fear what is happening in the current Middle East situation. So it's not going to do anything that would make the situation worse. It is going to try and do things that alleviate the situation and not cause instability or be trying to make the most of instability in the Middle East. It's got its own reasons for seeing peace in the Middle East.
Thank you. After this break, there will be one lecture actually. I invite you all to take part in the lecture, the paper will be presented by Dr. Karim Roue, a critique of Russia's relations with the Arab world since the Tsarist Empire. And Mr. Andriy Kortunov will also take part in this session. He will be talking about is there a role for Russia and the Arab world. We have 18 minutes of a break. Please be back at 7 o'clock sharp. So we have 15 minutes for the two lectures. Thank you.